blanks on one piece of solo. And again, the reason I'm doing this seriously is just to put things in context. When you open a book of the Bible and you start to read it, and it's interesting, but what does that have to do with anything? Mm-hmm. Well, again, to try to put it in context. So, we start the Bible with what?
Creation.
Creation. And if you can't accept that, you might as well close the book.
Yeah. Right.
If God did not create it, we simply evolved from monkeys or whatever, then it really doesn't matter.
Right. Okay.
Creation leads to what?
The
fall. And that affects the entire rest of the Bible story. From there, you have who?
Noah.
Remember, things got worse and worse and worse on planet Earth, and God was going to wipe everybody out. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord and restarted everything. After Noah, as all the people came together, they were going to exalt themselves with a tower at Babel or Babel. Right. And so God confused the nations, confused the languages. But out of that, He chose one family to be one nation in order to reveal Himself. And that was to who?
Abraham.
Abraham. Abraham has a son named
Isaac.
Isaac has two sons, Esau and
Jacob.
Jacob, whose name was changed to
Israel.
Which means what?
Prince with God.
Or he struggles with God.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Is it both or is it?
I'll have to go back and look. But anyway, yeah, he changed his name to Israel. And Jacob has 12 sons, one of those sons being
Joseph,
who ends up being sold into slavery in Egypt, but it's God's plan all along, and his family is saved, Egypt is saved, but they end up spending 400 years in Egypt as slaves, which leads to what?
The Exodus. Of
an
entire nation.
God has a plan, and he uses which man?
Moses.
And, of course, Moses is far more than just the Exodus. It's the Ten Commandments, it's the Levitical law and everything else, which leads to his successor, who was
Joshua,
who was involved in what?
The conquest
of the land, or you could almost say the reconquest. They were going back into the land, and they divided up into the 12 tribes. And then during that period of time, they were ruled by who?
The judges,
but you have that awful cycle where they would sin, and then they would repent, and God would deliver them, and then they would sin, and then you go on and on and on. Everybody was doing right in what?
Their own eyes.
So eventually they say, we want to be like all the other nations, and they ask for a king, and so we get the
monarchy.
The first king was who? Saul, who was an absolute flop. So God chooses who?
David,
and we have the Davidic covenant, and that affects the rest of the story of Scripture. It affects our study in the book of Matthew, because Jesus is called the son of
David
exactly.
Blind
David's son was who?
Solomon,
who builds the temple. And that's extremely important in for our story that we're in right now. And, of course, was the wise king, spread the largest the empire had ever been. But when he died, his son blew it, Rehoboam, and you end up with what?
Divided monarchy.
So you have the 10 tribes in the north, which are Israel, the 2 tribes in the south, which are Judah. However, in the book of Ezra, the remaining tribes that return to the land are often referred to as Israel. And so in Jesus' day, it talks about Israel. It's not talking about the 10 northern tribes. It's basically a reconstitution. So, all right. So then in 722, 721 BC, you have the fall of the northern kingdom, which was called what?
Samaria.
That was also their capital. And the Assyrians come down, take them captive. And God keeps sending warnings to Judah and Benjamin, but they won't listen. So 586 BC, you have what?
Fall
of Jerusalem, which leads to what?
70 years.
Babylonian captivity, 70 years in Babylon. But then, at the end, quite miraculously, as the Babylonians have been conquered by the Medo-Persians, mm-hmm. you have this Persian emperor by the name of Cyrus who issues a decree. And so you have the return to the land with the whole idea that they need to rebuild what?
The temple.
Exactly. And that's going to play into our story largely. So Ezra, we're going to see, he shows up in chapter 7, So he's not in the first group of returnees. He's in what you might call the second group of returnees. And by this time, the building has actually been assembled, okay? But they're really not ready for worship, and they have all sorts of problems going on, as we're going to see when we get to chapter 9 of Ezra, including intermarriage. But again, Ezra finds grace in the eyes of a Persian emperor who actually gives a command to Ezra to go back and restore worship and finances the worship. The whole thing is absolutely amazing. But we're going to take a look at some key verses out of Ezra today that shows that it's really not the Persian emperor who's doing this. Who is working behind the scenes?
God.
And Ezra gives credit to that. Esther, which comes in this period of time as well, never mentions God. But again, you see him as the unseen hand. Then we're going to go into Nehemiah, who's in charge of the rebuilding, actually, of the walls, the physical city of Jerusalem.
So how close are Daniel? Is Daniel's time to Esther's time?
Well, Daniel was at the very beginning of the 70 years. Mm-hmm. And he was a teenager, perhaps, at that time. So if you add 70, you know, he never returned.
Right.
He died in
probably 80 or 95 years old.
Right. So I'd have to go back and take a look. It was King Xerxes, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And so, again, it's during a period of near the end of that 70-year period of time. And they're still in Babylon. So, yeah. So, again, but Daniel survives the Babylonian Empire, goes on into the Medo-Persian Empire. God uses him in a mighty way. But basically, Daniel is at the very, very beginning, because he's actually one of these who's taken, and he's actually taken before the ultimate fall of Jerusalem. There was one in 609 BC, I think. So
he might have known Ezra.
He may have. Ezra was a priest.
Yeah.
And in fact, we're going to take a look at the genealogy of Ezra in our reading today in chapter 7. And it is the most complete genealogy of any individual, basically in the Old Testament. Which proves that he is a son of Aaron. Okay? He qualifies for the Aaronic priesthood, which means he was related to Moses. Yeah.
Oh, that's his brother.
Okay. So, anyway. All right. So does that put the context for you?
Great.
Okay. Again, remember, a text out of context becomes a pretext. And you can try to make it say all sorts of things. And that's one of the problems I have with some of these online little devotionals that come up. They'll take a verse out of the Bible, and then what they have to say about it has nothing to do with the context that was written. So you got to be careful. All right, so Ezra is qualified to teach. So your study guide is going to point out that many Bible commentators put Ezra almost on par with Moses. If Moses
gave
the law, delivered the law, Ezra interpreted it, taught it. Now, don't get us wrong, because Ezra was not a Pharisee. Okay? Ezra was teaching the Levitical law that had been given and calling the people back to faithfulness. And this is before the cross, before the gospel. Okay, so what he was doing was perfectly appropriate for who he was. So, all right. So somebody, you need another one of those?
No, I was just noticing the chart. Hadn't seen that before. That looks really good.
Ah, very good. Right, and this here is just a very basic timeline. But again, just to try to put things into perspective, because each one of these you could break down.
Yeah.
And for instance, when you come to the book of Judges, you can break it down and list all the different judges and who they were and all these things. But this is just to try to set it in context. All right. So would somebody read verses 1 through 10 of chapter 7, please?
It's got a lot of weird names. I'll do it.
a lot of weird names.
Now, after this, in the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Ezra, the son of Sariah, the son of Azariah, the son of Hilkiah, the son of Shalom, the son of Zadok, the son of Atadab, the son of Amariah, the son of Azariah, son of Meriah, son of Zariah, son of Uzai, son of Bukai, son of Abishai, son of Phinehas, son of Eleazar, son of Aaron, the chief priest. This Ezra went up from Babylon. He was a scribe skilled in the law of Moses that the Lord of the God of Israel had given, and King granted him all that he had asked for. The hand of the Lord God was on him. I need to go to 10.
Yes.
And he went up also to Jerusalem in the seventh year of Artaxerxes the king. Some of the people of Israel and some of the priests and Levites, the singers and the gatekeepers and the temple servants. And Ezra came to Jerusalem in the fifth month, which was in the seventh year of the king. For the first day of the first month, he began to go up from Babylon. And on the first day of the fifth month, he came to Jerusalem, for the good hand of God was on him. For Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord and to do it, and to teach his statutes and rules in Israel.
So, in my Bible, I highlighted the part of verse 9 and all of verse 10, where it says, in the NEV version, the good hand of his God was upon him, because Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. He was doing so and teaching the statutes and judgments in Israel. So this is why God was blessing him. He was truly a man of God. The Pharisees, and we're going to get into that this morning. I'm going to give you a little bit of a list. Because John the Baptist, or John the Baptizer, as we're going to call him, confronts these Pharisees who come down to the Jordan River for who they are. But Ezra seems to truly be a man of God and to truly be blessed by God, because he's truly seeking God. Now, again, for those of us who are New Testament Christians, who read Paul's writings, what he says about the law and things, we can become confused and say, well, does that make Ezra a bad person? No, it doesn't. Again, this is Old Testament. It's Old Covenant. It's before the cross. And these were laws given to Israel that they had broken. And now somebody needs to come along and teach these precepts, these laws again, and call them to repentance, and call them to a relationship with God. So, yeah, don't get confused.
So, it says he prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. That sounds a lot like the day of grace that we live in.
Oh, definitely.
Yes.
According to the book of Hebrews, people have always been saved by what?
By faith, through grace.
Exactly. Yeah. Even Abraham, of course, you know, he believed God and was accounted unto him as righteousness. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. So nobody is perfect, but again, Ezra's was a heart condition, and so this wasn't just simply things that were committed to memory in his brain, in his mind. This was yeah, I love what it has to say there. So, and again, your study guide says, after Moses, Ezra was the most important human figure in shaping of classical Judaism. So again, we need to be careful not to equate him with the Pharisees who come later. Okay, but he was doing good. Hmm. By the way, when it says son of, it literally means descendant.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, when I was doing our study of Matthew's genealogy, I thought it was very interesting, because when you read a modern translation, when it gets down to the bottom, when it talks about Adam, it says Adam, son of God. Well, I looked it up in the original Greek, and the only time son is mentioned is at the beginning of the genealogy. Every one of those basically says of. Well, the implication is that it's a form of writing that they are all descendants of or son of. But so we need to be careful interpreting when the scripture says that Adam was a son of God. It's different than Jesus being the son of God. It means that God created Adam. He came from God. So. All right. So there's a whole list of these, like 16 prominent names hit the high spots, and apparently it doesn't include everybody, and I don't understand that whole situation, but the main point is that it traces his lineage. If you take a look at page 24, was that what you were looking at earlier?
No, the chart was in the very center.
Oh, in the center, okay. But on page 24, you have also a chart of Ezra's lineage. And again, the whole concept here is that it goes back to Aaron. And Aaron, who was the brother of Moses. And so this qualifies Ezra to be then a priest. By the way, what is interesting today, we've mentioned to you that they have identified what they call the Kohanim in Israel, and these are people who qualify to be priests. They're actually training them in this center out in the desert, and they have found this through genealogical research, but also DNA research. So they have proof that these men are actually descendants of Aaron, even unto this day.
This chart is obviously abbreviated because there's more steps between Levi and then Aaron than are shown.
Right, yes, right. The whole idea, though, is in linking Ezra with Aaron.
Yeah, so you're going to go as clear back to prove, yes, he is a Levite, for sure.
So what we need to understand about Ezra is he's coming back. He is not writing the law. He's not inventing the law. He's simply teaching the law. Okay, so he's relating what has already been given to Moses. And again, on page 24 of your study guide, in the bottom right-hand corner, it says, as you read the book of Ezra, notice that he referred to the people in and around Jerusalem as Israel rather than Judah. So again, that can be confusing, okay? Because earlier on in the Old Testament, Israel is Israel. Then during the divided monarchy, you have Israel as a northern kingdom and Judah as a southern kingdom. Now you have Israel being used kind of an all-purpose statement. So, anyway.
Is that kind of just to show the inclusiveness of God's thoughts about Judah, even though Judah was just a small part of it? It was like, okay, this is Israel. Though they're not all there, I'm still remembering Israel.
Right, because they were the children of Israel.
Yeah.
They were the children of Israel. Not all the children. Well, I talked to a lady yesterday at the grocery store, and she asked about our Christmas, if we were having everybody. And I had to indicate, well, we're having our girls and their families, but not the boys, because one lives in Colorado, one lives in Virginia. She said, oh, well, then you're not all going to be there. I said, no. Jennifer and Jessica, we're having our children over. Okay, we can say that. We're having our children for Christmas. Yeah. We're not having all of our children, but we're having our children. And so I think that's where it kind of plays in there. So, but anyway, don't get confused over that fact. I know it's very confusing during the divided monarchy. When you read about Israel, you're talking only the 10 northern tribes that are on talking everywhere. All right. And then later on, When Paul says in the book of Romans, all Israel will be saved, what does he mean by that? You know, and again, there's quite a bit of controversy there. So apparently, Ezra had really good contact with Artaxerxes, who is the current emperor. And it apparently, according to your study guide, it looks like Ezra approached him and asked for permission to go back and do this needed work. But again, God was with him, God blessed him, and it mentions their trek just briefly. If you take a look at the very bottom of page 25 in the left-hand column, it says the most obvious quality of Ezra's personality was devotion. Devoted himself translates a Hebrew idiom that could be rendered fixed his heart on. And I think that's what you read, is that correct? And again, my version says prepared his heart. And so fixed his heart, prepared his heart, has the idea of this.
Yeah, when I read it, it said had set his heart.
Set his heart. Okay.
a fixed set, pretty much same idea.
Right. So I also underlined or highlighted a phrase on page 25 in the right-hand column where it says, his obedience was not a slavish legalism, but wholehearted devotion to the Lord. Later on, you see the Pharisees, and it is a slavish legalism. Okay, and we're going to talk about that again when they come down to the Jordan River to meet John the Baptizer. That's what I'm going to try to remember to call him this morning.
But the thing was, they were slavish to stuff they'd made up.
Exactly. Yeah.
It wasn't part of the original
thing
that God gave them. They had fixed up all these silly things.
In fact, it's been said by certain commentators that Jesus point blank broke Pharisaical rules.
I think he did
never
on purpose.
Broke the law of Moses.
I think he did.
But point blank in their face,
he broke
in front of them with some of their own legalistic rules.
I'd like when we're in theater, the disciples were walking through the wheat fields and eating. And
yeah.
You can't be doing this.
Yep. Pretty good. All right, so let's go to Ezra is authorized to strengthen worship in verses 11 through 20.
Now this is the copy of the letter that the king Artaxerxes gave unto Ezra the priest, the scribe, even the scribe of the words of the commandments of the Lord and of his statutes to Israel. Artaxerxes, king of kings, unto Ezra the priest, a scribe of the law of the God of heaven, perfect peace, and at such a time, I make a decree that all they of the people of Israel and of his priests and Levites in my realm, which are minded of their own free will to go up to Jerusalem, go with thee, for as much as thou art sent of the king and of his seven counselors to inquire concerning Judah and Jerusalem, according to the law of thy God, which is in thine hand, and to carry the silver and gold which the king and his counselors have freely offered unto the God of Israel, whose habitation is in Jerusalem, and all the silver and gold that thou canst find in all the province of Babylon, with a free will offering of the people and of the priests, offering willingly for the house of their God, which is in Jerusalem, that thou mayest buy speedily with this money bullocks, rams, lambs, with their meat offerings and their drink offerings, and offer them upon the altar of the house of your God, which is in Jerusalem. And whatsoever shall seem good to thee and to thy brethren to do with the rest of the silver and the gold, that do after the will of your God. The vessels also that are given thee for the service of the house of thy God, those deliver thou before the God of Jerusalem. And whatsoever more shall be needful for the house of thy God, which thou shalt have occasion to bestow, bestow it out of the king's treasure house.
Okay, thank you very much. So, if you were to look this up in Hebrew, how far could you interpret this? Not very good, far at all, because it's not written in Hebrew. It's written in Aramaic. This is one of those sections of the Old Testament that is recorded in Aramaic, like there's portions of Daniel that are in Aramaic. In the New Testament, you have some of the words of Jesus that are in Aramaic. So, this portion, this letter, is actually written in Aramaic. Now, if you noticed when Mark was reading, over and over again it talks about your God, the temple of your God is in Jerusalem, etc., etc., etc. On page 26 of your study guide, there is a box entitled Persian Concern for Jewish Spirituality. What is that all about? Can somebody read that for us?
Archaeologists found a document in Egypt containing official correspondence from Persia to Jews living in Egypt during the late 5th century reign of Darius II. The document illustrates the interests of Persian monarchs in the details of religions in the provinces. The letter reads as follows. To my brethren, Yedoniah and his colleagues, the Jewish garrison, your brother Hananiah. The welfare of my brothers may God seek at all times. Now this year, the 5th of King Darius, word was sent from the king to Arsames saying, authorize a festival of unleavened bread for the Jewish garrison. So count 14 days of the month of Nisan and observe the Passover. And from the 15th to the 21st of Nisan, observe the festival of unleavened bread. Be ritually clean and take heed. Do not work on the 15th or the 21st day, nor drink beer, nor eat anything in which there is leaven, from the 14th at sundown until the 21st of Nisan. For 7 days it shall not be seen among you. Do not bring it into your dwellings, but seal it up between these dates, by order of King Darius. To my brother Yedoniah and the Jewish garrison, your brother Hananiah.
So, what I think you have going on here is that the Persians were polytheistic, and they believed in many gods, and as was common of the day, they believed in local deities. So there was a god who was over the area that we would call modern-day Israel, especially Jerusalem. There were probably gods over other provinces. And they wanted to be on good terms with all these gods. Just like when Paul goes to Mars Hill in Athens and finds these statues. And there's all these different mythological gods. And finally, he finds one that is addressed to what?
The unknown god.
The unknown god. They were afraid. Maybe they forgot one somehow. And so Paul uses the occasion to say, well, let me tell you about him. And so, anyway, I don't believe that they were believers, as was Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, I believe, had a real salvation experience. God had to really humble him. But all these other emperors wanted to respect the cultures and the religions of the people they had conquered, which is different than the Assyrians. The Assyrians just wanted to obliterate everybody. They hauled them off, they resettled them, and things like that. So anyway, when you see this, and you have, like, for instance, the law of the God of Heaven, I don't think that Artaxerxes was a believer, but he believed that the Jews should respond to their own God. And apparently he realized that not only was there a temple, but he'd also given instructions as to what they were supposed to follow. And so I think that's what's going on here. By the way, I think it's really interesting. Over on page 27 of your study guide, it says, Artaxerxes put an elastic clause in his decree that permitted Ezra to use any excess funds as he saw fit toward the goal of implementing the will of God. One of the reasons why Hanford Nuclear Reservation and the WHOOPS project, Washington Public Power Supply, I think went belly up was it was cost plus. You know, these contractors are all given a bid plus, you know. And you know more about contracts and bids than I do. Can you imagine if you were invited into a home and the homeowner says, we want you to remodel this room, and you say, well, it might cost this, but it's going to cost whatever I say it's going to cost.
You better start writing your contracts like that, Mark.
Think yeah, that's a really good idea.
Yeah. 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 We call it the elastic clause. Right. And unfortunately, there are some contractors who have been really hurt during this last couple of years because they made a bid, mm-hmm. and then all of these supplies mm-hmm. skyrocketed. Anyway, so the interesting thing in here is that in the course of his decree, Artaxerxes referred to the Lord as the God of heaven, your God, the God of Israel, and the God of Jerusalem. And so, anyway, I think that Ezra believed all that, but I don't think that Artaxerxes was a true believer. All right, so, but basically he gives him permission to go back and to take whatever he needs. So let's take a look at the Ezra implements the law of God in verses 21 through 28.
And I, even I, Artaxerxes the king, do make a decree to all the treasures which are beyond the river, that whatsoever Ezra the priest, the scribe of the law of God of heaven, shall require of you, it be done speedily. unto 100 talents of silver, to 100 measures of wheat, 100 baths of wine, to 100 baths of oil and salt, without prescribing how much. Whatsoever is commanded by the God of heaven, let it be diligently done for the house of the God of heaven, for why should there be wrath against the realm of the king and his sons? Also, we certify you that touching any of the priests and Levites, singers, porters, Nethinims, or ministers of this house of God, it shall not be lawful to impose toil, tax, or custom, tribute upon them. And thou, Ezra, after the wisdom of thy God that is in thy hand, set magistrates, judges, which may judge all the people that are beyond the river, of all such as know the laws of thy God, and teach ye them that know them not. How many more?
28.
And whosoever will not do the law of thy God and the law of the king, let judgment be executed speedily upon him, whether it be unto death, or to banishment, or to confiscation of his goods, or to imprisonment. Blessed be the Lord God of our fathers, which hath put such a thing as this in the king's heart, to beautify the house of the Lord which is in Jerusalem, and has extended mercy unto me before the king and his counselors, before all the king's mighty princes. And I was strengthened, as the hand of the Lord my God was upon me, and I gathered together out of Israel chief men to go up with me.
All right, so at verse 27, you have a switch here.
It's Ezra.
It goes from the letter of Artaxerxes to now personal comments from Ezra. So basically, again, as Artaxerxes is finishing his letter, he's basically telling Ezra, whatever you need. Now, he is not prescribing what should be done, but he is saying you need to get all the supplies so that you can obey the law of your God. Mm-hmm. In which, whatever the requirements are, and it has to do with more than just animals. There's wine, there's oil, there's grain, there's the whole thing. There's even salt. And interestingly enough, there seems to be a measure. And by the way, if you take a look, at the bottom of my Bible, it says, it's just talking about some of these measurements. You have about 3 1/4 tons. Or 3.4 metric tons. Ooh. You have about 18 tons or 16 metric tons. You have about 600 gallons or 2,000 liters. So this gives you an idea of some of the amount of items. But when it came to salt, it was like all that you need. Which is interesting because salt was very, very valuable in that time. And again, we've already seen going through the Gospels that Jesus made comments about salt. And very, very, very impressive. So, what gets to me, though, is verses 27 and 28. Blessed be the Lord God of our fathers, who has put such a thing as this in the king's heart. Mm-hmm. So, Ezra realizes the true nature of what's going on here. Artaxerxes is acting as a servant of God. Now, he is an unrighteous heathen king. But even Nebuchadnezzar is called the servant of God before his humbling experience. So God can orchestrate events and cause people who don't even know him to accomplish his will. I got Ezekiel 38 and 39 on the brain because of what's going on with Russia and Putin and everything. But it's interesting there that it says God is going to put a hook in their mouth and draw them down. And so God does have influence over these kings. They don't always realize it, which is interesting. So, but anyway.
What was the king that threw Daniel in the lion's den?
Darius? Yeah.
So
now we have a Darius the second.
Oh, that's not the same guy?
I don't think so. I think there's Darius the first and Darius the second. Okay. Yeah, there's some of these names that are repeated. I have a chart somewhere that I had to do when I took Old Testament of all these different kings when they reigned.
Because he recognized too what was going on.
Oh yeah.
Like,
he did. He did. Okay. Exactly. Right, and some people call him Darius, some people call him Darius, tomato, tomato, potato, potato, whatever. Okay. But anyway, he said, thus I had been strengthened because the hand of the Lord my God was upon me. So again, Ezra seems to have a true relationship with God and realizes that God is orchestrating all of this. All right, so let's take a look here. There's an in brief section on page 30 of your study guide. It's going to summarize what's going on here. Can somebody read Ezra 8 in brief?
Ezra gathered an impressive group of family leaders and their kin who wanted to go with him back to the city of Jerusalem. Two of the clans were priestly families. Most were following relatives who had returned with Yeshua and Zerubbabel. He delayed departure 8 days while he found key Levitical families to infuse new vigor into temple ritual. Ezra would not accept an armed escort for the 900-mile journey. They trusted the Lord to guard them from bandits as they transported several tons of precious metals to the temple treasury. At the end of their four-month journey, Ezra and his company sacrificed praise offerings to God and delivered the imperial decree to the appropriate officials.
So he's got this decree in hand. He gets all of these items in hand. He gets these families, but now they've got to travel. And in one of the earlier lessons, we took a look at a map that shows basically the Fertile Crescent, how they go up the Tigris and Euphrates Valley up into what is modern-day Syria and Lebanon, and then down the coast. It's a crescent shape. But 900 miles, 4 months, and from what I was reading, the reason that Ezra does not want the king's soldiers, he's made quite a point to the king that God was going to provide and God was going to protect him. So he feels like it'd be hypocritical for him then to go to the king and say, well, now you need to protect us. So they set out, totally unarmed. And again, this was a trade route, and there were bandits, there were pirates, you might say, along the way. But God protected them the entire route with all this stuff. Again, I believe that was a miracle. So in my Bible, over on chapter 8, starting with part of verse 22, I highlighted this. The hand of our God is upon all who seek him for good, but his power and his wrath are against all who forsake him. And again, so I truly believe that Ezra had a view of God and realized that he was on a mission for God. This was not just their own idea. This was God's plan, God's will. And remember J. Hudson Taylor? God's work, done in God's way, will never lack God's supply. And Ezra had that attitude of mind. And it's a miracle. And now when we get into Ezra, we need to make a decision. Next Sunday is what?
Christmas.
Now, we are going to have a Christmas morning service that is going to be totally different. Basically, we're going to just get together and sing Christmas carols, and I might give a little devotional. Question is, do you want to meet for Sunday school? Now, I know some people can't be here at all. Others are going to have family. I'm going to be here no matter what because I need to open up the place. And in case anybody does show up, somebody needs to be here. So it doesn't matter to me whether you want to do Sunday school or not, but what is your wish?
No Sunday school.
I'll be here.
It's totally up to all of you, and again, because I'll be here no matter what to at least make sure the doors are open if anybody comes.
why don't we just go ahead and not have it that way? It'll even make the other service even more unique.
Sure.
Because that will be what we do.
Okay.
And then we can pray that the Lord will show you exactly what would be best for us to bring the greatest glory to His name and the touching of our hearts in a very unique.
So then when we get together, then the next Sunday is New Year's Day.
Ah, forget that one.
So go ahead and do Sunday school on that one.
Yeah, that way the people who are hungover got to get up anyway.
What are you planning to do?
Not me. I'm a teetotaler. I do not touch that stuff.
Okay, good.
Well, we can summarize chapter 4 because that ends in the book of Ezra.
I'll just give the pastor an out.
Spiritual reform. Hey, you remember what W.C. Fields used to say?
I know I do.
I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. But I too am a teetotaler. You don't have to worry about that. Trudy and I, our big question is, are we going to wear our pajamas to the living room New Year's Eve or not? So, yeah, we don't go anywhere. We don't do anything. We go to bed. And then right about midnight, we get woke up by our neighbors shooting off all this stuff.
We're going to bring our dog in the house.
Oh, my. Yeah. People go crazy.
Yeah.
And they save up all this stuff from 4th of July and start shooting it off. So.